took 10 million years to form. Now all my eyes can see are just the bleeding scars across the mountainside, across the mountainside. Culport, PA, just a little town tucked too far away for anyone to know. But the folks born and raised for 6 generations working day by day trying to keep themselves up.
Draglines by Deborah Silverstein and the New Harmony Sisterhood Band. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The Environmental Protection Agency took a significant step last week toward blocking one of Appalachia's largest and most disputed mountaintop removal coal mines. On Friday, the EPA proposed a veto of the Clean Water Act permit issued by the Army Corps of Engineers for the Spruce No. 1 mine in West Virginia. The mine's owned by a subsidiary of Arch Coal and would directly impact more than 2,200 acres of forests and 7 miles of streams. Sean Garvin of the EPA said, quote, "We must prevent the significant and irreversible damage that comes from mining pollution, and the damage from this project would be irreversible." The EPA's proposed determination faces a 60-day comment period before it can be finalized. Well, earlier this week, Anjali Kamat and I interviewed a photojournalist who's been chronicling the nonviolent fight against mountaintop removal coal mining. Antrim Kaski is embedded with Climate Ground Zero, a pressure campaign to stop mountaintop removal. She is the director of the journalism advocacy project Appalachia Watch, and her latest project is called Dragline.
Dragline is a 74-page photojournalistic expose of mountaintop removal coal mining in Appalachia and the campaign to end it. I created Dragline after almost 5 years of reporting on the subject in West Virginia, in Appalachia. It's designed to activate and to educate the American people on the atrocity that is mountaintop removal. And my work goes beyond just documenting what's going on. I've been witnessing now for years people's water being poisoned, mountains being blown apart in my subject's backyard. So while over the years I've been publishing this work, at this point I wanted to take the body of work and to create a tool, using photojournalism as a tool. And as my model, it's sort of an old-school photojournalism technique. It's photo-heavy, it's large format, and this is something that we don't see very much anymore because, as we know, these avenues are drying up for journalists. So I was able to go to allies and supporters and people who are interested to fundraise the money to create this, to create Dragline.
You are embedded with Climate Ground Zero. What is Climate Ground Zero, and what does it mean to be embedded with them?
Climate Ground Zero is a grassroots campaign based in Rock Creek, West Virginia. It's a campaign to stop mountaintop removal. The embed—
Mountaintop removal to you is?
Mountaintop removal is, as my friend Judy Bond says, strip mining on steroids. This is a type of modern coal mining where they use machines to take down the peaks of the Appalachian Mountains and to then push that rubble into the valleys below. So the valleys are rising and the mountains are falling, and they're flattening West Virginia, all for coal, the dirtiest fossil fuel. And these days, you know, this isn't a story about Appalachia, poor Appalachia. This is a story that concerns the globe because it's so critical connection to global warming. Dragline, the cover, the title and the image is meant to expose the coal industry for what they're doing today. What is a dragline? A dragline is a 20-story tall machine which has a giant bucket and a large boom with a bucket on the end. And this is the machine that they use to scoop up those blasted up mountaintops and to dump into the valleys below. The image on the cover of Dragline, it looks beautiful and mysterious, but that's actually a pit of poison, toxic coal waste, one of hundreds throughout Appalachia. They're unlined, and this is the— this is a—they call it an impoundment, but it's basically a toxic dump. It's the waste byproduct of the chemical cleaning of coal. And this is, again, the modern coal mining that I don't think a lot of people are really familiar with. It's a witch's brew of chemicals that they use to clean the coal. And this is a result of clean air legislation that was passed in the 70s. Where the stacks were cleaned. So the emissions coming out of the coal-fired power plant stacks, they took the chemicals and the sulfur and the NO2s out of that. And now that waste is transferred to the beginning of the process. So the coal is cleaned before it goes to market. But this coal sludge, this pond of it, as you see on the cover of Dragline, that's what we have left.
Antrim, you've been arrested 3 times while covering the story.
That's right.
Talk about the restrictions placed on you as a journalist while exposing what's happening.
Well, technically, I haven't been totally restrained in doing my reporting in the beginning. I crossed that line after years of witnessing this, and something has to be done, and I'm embedded with this movement, and so I went with activists to cover it. Now I'm suffering the consequences. I've been held in contempt of court. I'm subject to fines, to—
Contempt of court for what?
Contempt of court—well, let's backtrack a little bit. Last year, February 2009, there were 2 actions that month that I was arrested for documenting the protests. Massey Energy, the parent company of the subsidiary mining company where the actions took place, issued a temporary restraining order, which seeks to stop the activists, stop the journalists from doing what they're doing. I felt I had gotten to the point of such a saturation of knowledge of the issue and listening to the local people. I'm on the ground and hearing what's going on. So I felt confident in what I was doing. I was doing the right thing. And if I wasn't going to do this, if I wasn't going to go with the activists and cover it, I think I would be negligent in my job.
And what were you documenting?
I was documenting the nonviolent civil disobedience campaign, where the activists go onto the active mine sites and peacefully demonstrate. They may lay down in a haul road, blocking traffic and blocking the movement of coal. Or in other cases, they've locked themselves to machinery, all in a peaceful, nonviolent way, in the tradition of Martin Luther King and Gandhi. That may seem a little overblown in comparison, but there really is no other comparison. This is the equivalent to the lunch counter sit-ins. It's just as urgent of a cause.
And what has happened to them?
To the activists? Well, slowly but surely, the court system has punished them further and further. In the beginning of 2010, we've seen a lot of the activists go to prison. Go to jail. 3 of them spent 15 days in jail just a few weeks ago. That was Mike Rozelle, Tom Smith, and Joe Hampshire. But there's an escalation that's we have seen in the punishment of these cases. You know, first we got into the courts in March 2009, and with the persistence and the refusal to obey this criminal corporation's temporary restraining order and the, frankly, corrupt courts in West Virginia that are bought and paid for by the coal industry.
What do you mean?
Well, coal in West Virginia is a mono economy, and it basically controls and has infiltrated every level of the power structure, from the governor to the courts all the way down. And your viewers may be familiar with Don Blankenship, the CEO of Massey Energy, who basically purchased the state Supreme Court seat for Brent Benjamin.